Hello, welcome to another video. In this video, I am again talking about how to get more than 5,000 items from SharePoint. I've already done a video on this and it's proved to be quite popular. The reason that I'm revisiting it is because the flow that I built before worked perfectly well, but it was quite complicated. And when I revisited it and really examined what was going on in that flow, I realized that I could get rid of a lot of what was in there and make it much easier to implement. If we have a quick look at the old flow, we can see that there is just a lot going on. The new one is a similar concept, but just implemented in a much more straightforward way. And you can literally build this in a few minutes. I do want to say, this isn't the flow to use. If all you want to do is get more than 5,000 items from SharePoint for use in some other action or flow, this is specifically if you have got a SharePoint list with more than 5,000 items in it and you want to get the data back to PowerApps or a HTTP connector. This is performance focused, and so every possible step that can be cut out from the flow has been cut out. The idea being that if somebody's using a PowerApp and they're waiting for a response, we need to get that down to the minimum possible time. So let's take a look at it and go through each step of it. I will put the flow on my blog, so you can just import it into your environment. It's very easy to do, just have to update the SharePoint connector and away you go. I will also show this time how to actually connect the data into PowerApps, because some people got stuck with that before. So at the top, we've got PowerApps, which is our trigger. And then we have a compose action called query settings. In here, you define the list name and the columns that you want to retrieve. Keep the columns that you want to retrieve down to the absolute minimum. If you've got a lot of rows, you want to have as few columns as possible to make this procedure as fast as possible. Then we have two SharePoint API calls. This gets the lowest ID in the list and the highest ID, so we know from which range to collect the data. Now, this is probably the most important part in here for you to configure. There is an array variable called threads. This threads array defines how many simultaneous SharePoint queries it will execute to get your data. Each thread will get 5,000 rows. So in my case, I've got four threads, 0, 1, 2, and 3. So that's going to get me up to 20,000 rows of data. If you've got 10,000, you're going to need two threads. And if you've got 30,000, you're going to need six. So adjust that, but keep it down to the minimum number of threads that you need to cover the amount of rows that you've got. So then we get down to here. Items per thread. This is just a calculation where it tries to figure out the optimal number of items to get in each thread. And then we go into an apply to each loop, and that's each thread. Now, the important thing here is if we go into the settings, we can see that I've got concurrency control turned on, and I've got the number of concurrent runs set to 4. And that is equal to the number of threads that I've specified above. So when we hit this for each loop, it's going to execute 4 times, but simultaneously, not sequentially. So it figures out the low ID. It figures out the high ID for this thread. So where it's going to start looking for records and where it's going to end looking for records. And then it does the SharePoint query based on the query settings that we saw above. So once that's done, let's close this up. I'm going to come back to this sample output in a minute. Then it does a union action, which we can see here, and unions the output from this query SharePoint action. This will come out of this apply to each loop as an array of arrays. So we access each element of that array, 0, 1, 2, and 3, and bring them all together. And the union is the thing that takes the longest in this flow. So that is why you should keep the number of threads as low as possible, and you should keep the number of columns that you're retrieving as low as possible. This sample output takes two records from the first element of the apply to each loop. This is simply to give you some sample data so that you can do this generate from sample step, which will generate a JSON schema for you to use in this response action. I will show you that in a moment. So if I test the flow, okay. So how long did it take? It took 5 seconds, which is actually longer than I expected. But by the way, this is collecting 17,000 rows in this example. So this sample output gives you a nice, easy place to pick up a couple of records, which you can then put into the response action. If we go and edit the flow, we can click on generate from sample and click done. And that'll build that for us. This union step, I will just bring that out so you can see it. This unions each output from the apply to each. So if you've got 6 threads, then you're going to need to put another 2 lines on this here. Right, so now we've built the flow. Let's put it into a Power App. It's really easy to do. So I am going to put on a button and then go to Power Automate. And then here is my flow here, over 5,000 V7. And then up here, I'm just going to close those parentheses off. So that will be enough to run the flow, but it won't give us our data back inside of the Power App. So I'm going to do a clear collect sample data. And that will load the output from this flow into that collection called sample data. So I am just going to run that quickly so that we can verify that that is the case. So if we go into collections, we can see that we've got some data loaded now. So I am going to insert a data table and I'm going to use sample data, my sample data collection, as the data source. I'm going to add some fields. I'll have the ID, title, last name, email, and telephone. Okay, so we can see there that's all come through fine. So there we have the complete set of records. I'm just going to resort it so that we can see all the items there. So if I just do sort by the ID descending, then we can see there we've got 17,000 rows. It's not bad, you know, it's pretty quick. The other thing that I use this for is if I'm returning data back to a HTTP connector, and I've done a separate blog post on this, but it works just as well in that environment. So let's have a quick look at that. So here I've just got a piece of jQuery which is calling exactly the same flow except it's using HTTP as its connector. And there we can see the 17,000 rows have loaded in. If I shorten that down and sort it by the ID, we can see the same set of data there. And in here, you know, you can do all the things that you would expect to be able to do. Group it and search it and all those sorts of things. And that's all there is to it, really. So I will put the flow on my blog for you to download. It really is very easy. This is the HTTP version. See how you get on. If you get stuck, leave a comment on my blog or on this video and I will help you out. But hopefully you should be able to nail this pretty quickly because it is very easy. And I've been working with somebody who's already implemented this and it worked perfectly for them. So good luck.